He made Father's Day. So I'm going to rejoice and be glad. Moms, you're going to rejoice and be glad in Father's Day? Yeah. Amen. I came in this morning and they wished me Happy Father's Day. And I said, Happy Father's Day to you too. I said it to the ladies, you know. And I said, I'm such a generous person. I'm going to share my day with you. Amen. Amen. We all get to partake in Father's Day and Mother's Day and St. Patrick's Day. Oh, wait a minute. No. Going overboard now. Amen. Not knocking the Irish. I have some in me. Amen. A lot of you don't know that. Hallelujah. What do you say we pray? Father, we thank you for this is the day you made. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, we thank you that you're in the midst of us. Holy Spirit, have your way in our lives today. I thank you that your anointing is here this morning, that your anointing is upon the word, and it's the anointing that breaks every yoke of bondage off of our lives. We thank you that the spirit of wisdom, the spirit of revelation is on your word, because Jesus, you are the word. So I thank you this morning that we gain wisdom and we gain understanding and we are able to put it in our life in practical application. I thank you, Lord, that your word is sent and doesn't return void, but accomplishes to the purpose that it's sent. So I thank you that we are going to be so fruitful that we have no choice but to rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. How many of you brought your Bible with you this morning? Amen. Amen. I have a question for you. How many of you here have a dream? How many of you have a dream? How many of you have a desire? How many of you have a goal that you want to obtain? We're going to talk about this morning. God is good, isn't he? In the book of Colossians. Now remember, I speak to each and every one of us all the time as, not as if, because you are, but I speak to you all as leaders because I view each and every one of you as a leader. God has called you out of darkness. You have a calling in your life. Each and every one of us are called to rule and reign in life. If you're ruling and you're reigning in life, that means you're a leader, right? Turn to your neighbor and say, you're a leader. You got two choices. You could either lead or follow. In a race, the followers never win. It's always the leader who wins. I had the opportunity to see that horse race a couple weeks ago, you know? And it was cool. It's something you see history. I don't gamble. I don't go to the track. I just thought it would be pretty cool to see if it would finally happen this year, the old Triple Crown. And it was pretty cool to see this wonderful creature run almost effortlessly, you know. The rest of them horses, they didn't win. No wreath around their neck, just that one American Pharaoh horse. Interesting name. Sometimes there's prophetic meanings in names. Amen. Colossians chapter 1. Are you there? Verse 9 and 10. It says, for this reason we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you. Isn't that wonderful? Amen. We don't cease to pray for you guys. And to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will. How many of you know God has a will for you? God has a plan for you. And if you didn't know it, this is his will. This is his plan right here. In all wisdom and spiritual understanding, verse 10, that you may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Amen. The voice says it this way. Since the day we got this good news about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We ask. Now he goes in. The voice changes it into a prayer. Okay. This is a prayer for knowledge and insight that only comes from God. Father, may they clearly know your will and achieve the height and the depth of spiritual wisdom and understanding. May their lives be a credit to you, Lord. And what's more, may they continue to delight you by doing every good work and growing in the true knowledge that comes from being close to you. Amen. Amen. Good word. God wants us to grow and be filled with knowledge and increase in that knowledge of God. Right? That's what the first verse, the New King James Bible says. The word knowledge in the Greek here means recognition. So he prays that they would be filled with the recognition of his will. You see, we pray that you would recognize the will of God for your lives. We need to recognize what's God's will and what's not God's will. Do you know that the devil has a will for you too? The devil has a plan for you to steal, kill, and destroy. The devil has a plan for you. It's called tradition. The devil has a plan for you. It's called religiosity. The devil has a plan for you. It's called lukewarm. The devil has a plan for you not to be effective. The devil does not want you effective for the kingdom of God. He just wants you to exist. As long as you go to church and as long as you read a Bible and you don't apply it to your life, he's fine with that. As a matter of fact, the devil would even drive you to church as long as you remain stagnant. Hey, what better? You got unsaved people. What better than that? Of course, hypocrites. That's always better than those that don't know better. Right? We don't want to be in that place of hypocrisy. So growing, that we would know the knowledge of his will, recognition. By implication, it means the full discernment and the acknowledgement of his will. But then it says the full discernment and acknowledgement of God himself. So God wants us to discern, and God wants us to be aware and come to that place where we know exactly what God's plans for our life is. Can you say amen? Amen. God's best for us is that we become successful in every endeavor that we pursue. God wants us to be the best at everything we do. God wants us as his children to be the leader of the pack. Is there anything wrong with that? Absolutely not. God wants us to be fruitful and to multiply. The word that we just read was that we would be fruitful in every good work. God wants us to bear fruit in everything that we do. Let me put it to you in English. Everything we do, we should be profitable in. And it doesn't just mean money. Turn to your neighbor, not just money. You could have all the money in the world and have no peace in your life. You're not prospering. Amen? You could be the richest person watching me right now on Ustream, but you're paranoid because you think everyone wants your money. No prosperity in that, folks. God wants you to lead and to rule and reign in this life. Sadly, so many Christians fall short of God's best. They fall short because, first of all, they're taught things like, well, you know, Jesus was poor and Jesus was homeless. The Bible says he had no place to lay his head. Right, because he wasn't in his hometown. As a matter of fact, the Bible actually alludes that Jesus might have had not just one, but quite possibly owned two homes. Right? But we take scripture and we're taught wrong. We're taught that it's wrong to talk about prosperity. It's not wrong to talk about prosperity as long as you're balancing it with righteousness. Because we're not preaching a gospel of greed. Because I said in the beginning, we need to be people who are selfless. We're not doing it for self-gain. We're not seeking after God's best so we can hoard up all of our treasures on earth. Our treasures are stored up in heaven. God blesses us so we could be a blessing to establish his covenant, so we can feed the hungry. I've said it time and time and time again. If the church would understand their role and their responsibility, and if Christians would understand their role and responsibility, and who God said that you are to be, the church would step up and eradicate poverty in this nation. Amen. Instead, we leave it for the government, and they can't even get the motor vehicle to run right, the motor vehicle department. You know what I'm saying? We put it in the hands of unspiritual men who are corrupt and greedy anyway, who end up sucking it up for themselves anyway, who put it in these different programs where they can't release the money just yet. If the church would step up and rise up to the level of prospering, and the believers begin to prosper, then there wouldn't be poverty. The church is the welfare system, according to God's plan and design. Amen? Again, he wants to overtake us for blessing, not so we could have gold-plated Cadillacs like Reverend Ike had. No. I knew someone who worked for him, who did some cooking for him. And he had a sign up in the bathroom of his house. This person was a chef. They would go and cook for him. And he had a sign up in his bathroom. And it said, "Please clean up after yourself. Don't forget, I'm the goose who lays the golden egg." Nice, huh? Arrogance, you know, pride. Well, we know what he was anyway, right? We know he wasn't the real deal Holyfield. Amen? There was an NFL coach. His name was George Allen, senior. Any football? He coached, I believe, the Rams and also the Redskins. He said this: every man is born with the ability to do something well. That is what the Lord intended him to do, using that ability. What life is all about. You see, God has called you and God has equipped you and God has given you special abilities. Each and every one of us has giftings of God in us. And God wants us to walk to the full stature to do the best that God has called us to do. Because we're leaders. Second place doesn't work in the kingdom of God. Would you agree? Yeah. Amen. Is it warm in here? Can't we be in agreement? I'm going to fix that because I'm sweating. You still love me, right? Ah, thank you, Jesus. Yeah, it's more soupy than hot, absolutely. He also said, George Allen Sr., "The Creator does not give man the longing to do that which he has no ability to do." Amen? We could do what seems impossible. Turn to your neighbor, you could do the impossible. You could do the impossible. You can do the impossible. Amen? Amen? You can trample on serpents and scorpions and grind them into the floor like a cockroach or any other bug you prefer. Some of you have a favorite bug, I don't know. Amen? We were created in the image of God. And he has deposited within our spirit the ability to accomplish great things. God called you out of darkness. God has equipped you. God has anointed you. God has even ordained you for great works in the kingdom of God. What does it mean, great works? Psst, they'd be noticed. Great works are always noticed. How many of you love art? Go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art, and you go to the wing of mediocre art. Doesn't exist, does it? But they go and they hang the great works, the Rembrandts, right? And all them wonderful artists, whoever they may be. It's not my thing. I'm a blue-collar guy. What could I say? Car guy. Who, that? What? Car guy, that's right. We're going to talk about that in a minute, too. To accomplish great things, we must first possess a dream. Another word for a dream would be a vision. Another word for vision would be a desire. Another word for desire might be goal. Do you have a desire to be used by God? Do you have desires to change this world? Do you have desires to be great? How many of you want to be great? How many of you don't? Some people don't want to be great. Some people are on the witness protection program and they don't want to be noticed. There is no witness protection program in the kingdom of God. You are called out. You are recognized. You are noticed. You are an ambassador. You represent the kingdom of God. There is no hiding allowed. Because once you hide, he exposes you. That's just the kind of God he is. Amen? Because his will be done. Can you say amen? Amen. Hallelujah. So we were all created with his image. God is a visionary. God has great dreams for each and every one of us. He had a great vision and a great dream before he even created this universe. And you were it. Amen? Can you imagine God dreamed about us? Maybe he had bad pepperoni pizza that night. I don't know. He dreamt about using nothing more than dirt that just has his breath of life in it. See, that'll keep you humble. We're nothing but dirt filled with the breath of God. Right? Turn to your neighbor and say, hello, dirt. No, don't do that. In Proverbs 29, repent for calling your neighbor dirt. Repent. Repent. Proverbs 29:18, and the voice says, where there's no vision from God, the people run wild. Right? Where there's no vision, the people perish. Where there's no vision, the people separate themselves. Where there's no vision, people come apart. The voice says, where there's no vision, the people run wild. But those who adhere to God's instruction know genuine happiness. You see, here's the thing. We need to make sure that the goals and the dreams and the desires that we have are from God. But God is also concerned about the dreams and the desires you have. A lot of you know that when I was younger, I had a dream and a desire to be a charter boat captain. I wanted to be a fisherman, right? And then looking at some shows like Deadliest Catch and Wicked Tuna and all these shows, that's a pretty rough life. Pretty rough life to live, but it's a lot easier than pastoring a church. A lot less messy. The worst that happens is you smell like bait or you're drowned. I'm just saying. You know, this takes a lot more than that. That's right. We're all fishers of men, right? You're all part of the SS Pillars. You're all chartered this ship to go out and catch a harvest. Amen? Problem is that some of you ain't putting your bait out. I don't know about you. It's kind of hard to catch anything with an empty hook, right, Frank? Although once in a while you do get an accidental snag. Sometimes we snag people into the kingdom by mistake. I didn't even want to get that one saved. They just followed me into the church. I don't know how it happened. Came up to me and said, hey, you know anything about salvation? And I was on the spot. I had to lead them to the Lord. You know. But that doesn't happen too often. Amen. So the first thing here, to accomplish great things, is we must possess a dream. Next, you must believe that you have the God-given ability to fulfill that dream. Psalms 37:4, you know it well. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. See, God is concerned about the desires of your heart. It's not just about what he wants for you. But there are kind of legalese fine print that goes around that, because your desires of your heart need to line up with his will. You know, if your desire is to be the best Buddhist on earth, it's not going to happen in Christ Jesus. You understand? It has to be according to his will. So if we know his word, if we know his last will and testament, we know exactly what we're entitled to. You know, it's pretty sad. I was talking to Nada, I think it was Friday night, when we went to Stop 20. I like blues music, and you know, most of you know that B.B. King just passed away. And even before he was dead, the family was fighting over his, you know, fighting over his estate. Suspicious that his manager might have poisoned him, you know. Really, really, really just terrible stuff. In his will and his wishes, he made known that he did not want to be autopsied, but yet they cut him up. All because of what they want, what they want, what they want. You know, if they just would have stuck to the will, they would have realized that he left enough money for all the grandchildren and great-grandchildren to go to college. His children, they only got like $1,000 each. Or whatever it was. But trust me, he took care of them in life. So sometimes if we don't know the stipulations of the will, we walk around complaining, and we walk around dog-faced and hurt, and we walk around, how come nobody loves me? You got to do things according to the will. Amen? Amen? You know what I say? Where there's a will, there's a relative, right? Where the will is, the Holy Spirit is. You're related to God. He's not a stranger. He's your father. Can I get amen? Amen. Father's Day? Amen. Amen. So first, possess the vision. Second, believe that you have the God-given ability to fulfill that dream. Third, once you recognize that dream and it's established, you must establish a plan of action to fulfill those dreams. Having a desire to be something or to obtain something and doing nothing about it is pretty foolish. And if that's you, hypothetically speaking, because I know it doesn't apply to anyone here, if that is you, you have no right to complain about your life. Because if you have God's grace and you have God equipping you, and you have all the power and the wisdom and the insight and divine favor and all these things that I've taught about over the past 3 years to you, you have no right to complain if things aren't working out your way. You need to establish a plan on how to achieve it. How do you achieve greatness? By sitting in a chair and watching TV. Watching the Cartoon Network 14 hours a day will do it, right? Probably not. It's getting out of your comfort zone. Going and doing something that may require some strength, maybe some sweat, maybe even shedding a little bit of blood in the process. I don't know. It's your vision, not mine. Right? I have a vision for you. I have a vision for this church. How many know what the vision for this church is? For you to be fruitful and multiply, to raise people in discipleship and disciple people into being leaders, to raise people up and possibly send them out to begin new works. That's what God calls a church for. That's what you've been called here for. That's what God has brought you here for. And you need to come to that place of allowing God's dream, God's vision for your life to happen. A lot of times we work against what God wants. Is anyone guilty of that? Put my hand up first. Humankind is guilty of that. So we need to rearrange our priorities at times. Matter of fact, not at times, all the time. Amen? Because we need to seek after God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind and our strength. We need to seek his face instead of just seeking his hand. We need to cry out to God when things are good, not only when things are bad. Amen? It's sad because as a pastor, you see a lot of things. You watch people grow. You watch some people slowly grow. You watch some people and you have to check their pulse to see if they're alive, you know? And then you see other people that are just growing by leaps and bounds because they have the desire to know God. And they have the desire maybe to be used by God, and maybe God has given them a vision. But where there's no vision, you don't run wild, you just sit. You just sit. And you just sit. And you wait, and you wait, and you say, God, how come nothing changing? And you say, God, I've been waiting. And God says, yeah, me too. God has equipped you even before you were saved for greatness. God's children are not failures. God's children are not losers. God's children are not mediocre. God's children are exceptional. Amen. Turn to your neighbors. Now he's talking about me. Amen. Finally, you must be willing to persevere regardless of the opposition or the adversity that you might encounter. You know, when you have a dream and you have a desire, you have a goal, and you start to move forward, everything in hell is going to try to stop you. The people that you think love you the most will rise up and stop you. It might be a spouse. It might be a coach. It might be your boss. I don't know. It might be your very best friend. But you persevere, and you go through it anyhow. You see, we need to decide quickly if the dreams we have are true dreams. Because sometimes people just have fantasy. They just have fantasy. You know what the difference between a dream and a fantasy is? Fantasies are unattainable. Dreams are. Fantasy is unattainable. But then there's the other side of the spectrum. God is a balanced God, you know. If we take anything to an extreme one way or another, we miss God. So we either have the divine dream and the vision, the purpose that God has laid hold of us, or we have fantasy. Or we have small-mindedness. And small-mindedness is this. Well, my vision is to go to church one extra day a week. Very small-minded. Granted, maybe your dream may begin at that, but if that's the end of how great you're going to be in the kingdom of God, that's small-minded thinking. Last time I checked, God is not small-minded. God is not small. Jesus called these fishermen. There we go, fishermen. He didn't call the educated ones. He didn't call the Bible scholars. He called the ones that used four-letter words. He called the ones that smelled a little bit. Sailors could be rough around the edges, you know what I mean? No, you don't know? Yesterday was the 40th anniversary of Jaws. Dum, dum, dun, 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 right? Captain Quint was rough around the edges. He was outright offensive. But that's how fishermen are, people. That's who Jesus called. Jesus called the Quints. Right? To change the world. And they did. Now, us who are so dignified and are high school graduates and college degrees and have 35 years of work experience under our belt, of course he could use you. Turn to your neighbor and say, what are you waiting for? Amen. Page 2. We have yet to read the life story of a person who has accomplished great things, who did not experience hardships. The most successful people in the world are those who are passionate about their dream and refuse to quit until it became reality. Thomas Edison, you know that guy? He was an inventor. He made a lot of things. They say he tried 1,000 times to create the light bulb. And the person said, don't you feel like a failure? And he says, no, I just learned 1,000 things not to do. You know, we have to have the right attitude. We can't be discouraged. We go forward and we go forward. And with the help of the Holy Spirit, he leads us and he guides us. And he opens doors that no man can open. And he shuts doors that no man can shut. And he makes the way. His steps he gives us are ordered by him. And we walk in those steps. We hear his voice. We're led by his spirit. We seek direction. Lord, what do I do? What's my next move? Listen, how can we fail when he already has the answer? He already knows the end, even before you got there. And if you have a vision in faith, you already know the end. Amen. Because that's what faith is. It's believing what hasn't happened yet. Hello? Is this thing on? And all the fathers said amen. Amen. Perseverance is the price of achievement. What does it mean to persevere? No matter what, I'm not giving up. Hell or high water, I'm not stopping. It's kind of like running a church, you know? There's a lot of things that can become very discouraging as a leader. I'm sure if you ask my mom, I'm sure if you ask Rosie, I'm sure if you ask Nada, I'm sure if you ask some people that have been around, there's a lot of things that become discouraging. Well, they try to discourage. You know, when Pastor Anthony went home, we had the wonderful opportunity of saying, what do we do? Was it all about him? And do we shut the doors? Or do we persevere? When we went, in a matter of 3 to 4 months, from 225 people to 70 people, what do? We persevere and we go on. Right? When the offerings don't look good, what do? We quit. No, we persevere and we go on. Right? Sadly, that's not true for a lot of Christians. As soon as the pressure comes up, they quit. As soon as they face some adversity, they say, this Jesus stuff don't work. Or they throw in the towel. Don't ever throw in the towel. Amen? Just when you think things are hopeless, the greatest breakthroughs come. Amen. Amen? Because that's what the loving God that we serve does for us. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 3, New King James. I'll give you a second to get there. I'll grab a water. How many of you love the Lord?
Amen.
It was 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 to 3. It says, you, stop. Who's he talking to? You. You, therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Let me just stop. What he's saying is here, the things you heard me teach, you teach to them so they can turn around and teach others. So they, in turn, can turn around and teach others. So what he's saying is, Timothy, I'm putting you in, I'm setting you in as a pastor. Everything I've done, you do. And raise up other leaders and send them out so they could do as I did, as you did, as they did, as those do. Sorry, my Brooklyn got in the way. Amen. Verse 3, you therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Isn't that an encouraging scripture? You must endure hardship. It didn't say, you know, there might be a possibility of hardship. If you have a dream, if you have a vision, if you have a goal, you must persevere and know this, you're going to experience some hardship along the way. I thought you were going to edify me. I am. Because if I don't warn you, then you're going to come back and say, you didn't tell me! Endure hardship like a good soldier. It doesn't say like a good baker. We have a couple good bakers in the house. Don't take it personal, okay? Right? Like a good soldier. Soldiers are prepared for war. Soldiers are looking for battle. Even when they're afraid, they're looking for battle. Because the ones who aren't looking for battle end up becoming deserters. Right? They're the ones that hide in the foxhole, and as soon as the guns, they take off, they're out of there. Endure hardship like a good soldier of Jesus Christ. There are two simple words that have caused more failure in this life, not just in the church, but in this life, than any other two words. You know what those two words are? You do? Oh, I can't. Say with me, don't you dare. I can't. My goodness, that is an oxymoron to faith. Because faith believes the word. Faith speaks the word. Faith lives the word. I could do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can't. I could do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You ever stop and think about the word all? Through Jesus, through the word, through building up yourself in faith, through the anointing of the Holy Spirit, through the giftings and the callings, and through the guidance and the leadership at Pillars, you could do what seems impossible. Amen. But what's impossible to you at this very moment? Does your life seem like it's an impossible situation? There is nothing impossible for those who believe. Wherever you see in your word, who believe, that means have faith. There is nothing impossible for those who have faith. Nothing impossible for those who stand on the promise of God and claim them as their own, who speak them out of their mouth, who meditate on the word day and night, not stopping the word from coming out of your mouth. Joshua 1:8, he says, when you do this, you make your own way prosperous. And then you have good success. You see, we want God to do it, and God wants you to do it through him. We know how to pray the prayer of petition. How many of you know what the prayer of petition is? Help! That's generally what the prayer of petition is. I need you! But you know, there's about 14 other types of prayers in the Bible. But the one we know most is, help! I'm stuck! And when God has furnished you with the answers, begin to speak the word. Meditate on the word. Speak the word. Decree the word. Pray the word. You know, praying the word is the only right way to pray. Reminding God of what he's already promised you is legally yours. Oh, dear God, can you please help me? Oh, I can't pay my bills. The baby has no food. I need new shoes. My car only has 3 tires. Haven't paid my rent in 4 months. And God says, tell me something I don't know. See, that doesn't move God. I believe that bores God. Because he says, my people don't know me. We need to speak the word over these situations, over these hardships, whatever it is that we find ourselves in. We are not to be moved by circumstance. We are not to be moved by what we see or what we hear. We need to be moved by faith, which means we need to rise up in our faith to God. Amen. Faith is an undeniable belief that God is in control. As long as you put him in control. Amen. Amen. The only limitation you have are those you set up in your own mind or those which you have allowed others to set up in your mind. Amen. Oh, you can't do that. You're being stupid. Watch me. Instead of saying, you're right. I'm a weakling. I got no power. I can't do all things through Christ. Do you understand? Sometimes we're raised with a mentality, something I call a poverty mentality. Poverty mentality doesn't just have to do with your finances. Poverty is when you think less of yourself than God thinks of you. When you think your worth is based on everything else other than what God said about you. That's a poverty mentality. With a poverty mentality, you are always looking for people to validate your weakness instead of looking to God who's going to exalt you above every situation and circumstance. You might have to go through it, but he will see you through. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You know, it says I walk through it. It doesn't say I move in. Too many Christians pitch a tent there. When they fill out their change of address, Valley of Death, Death Valley. I'm moving to Death Valley. Because it's a wonderful place. Vultures, snakes, sand, and no water. You understand? But sometimes in our life, we settle. And we settle because people put limits on you all the time. Government puts limits on you all the time. You can't do that. Who do you think you are? I'm royalty. Who do you think you are? Oh, obviously a nobody. Because we're not carnal, because that leads to death. We're not fleshly, because that leads to death. So we're super spiritual, but in a good sense. Not, look at me, I'm so holy. We are supernatural beings. We are superhuman, if you would. You're a superhero. Turn to them and say, you're a superhero. Who do you want to be? Superman? Batman? Who do you want to be? You're a superhero, able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. Able to leap obstacles in a single bound. Able to do the impossible. Again, a dream is something that if you could obtain it in your own strength, it's not a dream. My dream is to go to work on Monday. You were going anyway. Consuelo, you're laughing, right? I just heard your voice. You know, where are you? She's hiding now. There she is. She got hold of a dream and a vision, right? Through a prophetic word that Joe Cantaldi spoke over your life, right? And now you went ahead and ventured out into a field that was almost a non-existent field, right? Baby nurse, right? And she's teaching brand new mothers how to raise their children, how to care for them properly for the first 3 or 4 months of their life. And she goes and she lives, and now she has a whole company. How many people you got working with you? 10 people working with you now. 10 nurses that are going into homes. And what they do is they go in, and they're all Christians, and they go in and have an opportunity with the parents' permissions, Christians, Muslims, Jews. Hey, can I dedicate your baby to the Lord? And how many of them have said no? None. You see? A vision, a goal, obtain it. Seems strange, seems impossible, but there's a spiritual application to it, as well as, I'm sure you're doing okay. Amen? Amen. Sometimes we feel safe and we look for jobs only in the fields we think we could do. Hey, you know what? You could do the impossible. You could do the things you were never trained to do. You got the Holy Spirit in you. You have the creator of creativity living in you. There's nothing you can't do. Now, I'm not going to say tomorrow go become a cop. You know, you got to go to police academy. And you got to pass that psych test. So, you know, I'm not sure. No, I'm kidding. You know. There are steps you do have to take, right? You're not just going to walk up and jump in a cop car and take his gun and say, come on, let's go get some criminals. They'll say, you are one. Put the cuffs on them. Why don't you cuff yourself if you want to be a cop? You understand? Amen. God is good, isn't he? So again, the only limitation you have are the ones which you set up in your own mind. If you think you're limited, you will be. If you think you'll never amount to nothing, you'll never amount to nothing. If your parents told you things like this, don't go to school. You're just going to get married anyway. Aim high, baby. Aim high. Because you don't know what God's going to do. Sometimes we go through something, we aim high, and we're not even sure why we're doing it. You know? And then God reveals something through his divine favor or through her connection to bring you to a place that you never would have imagined he would have brought you to. We have a guy that went through actually, he never finished the program. He came to the program many years ago. His name is Robert, man. Yo, man, what's up, dude? Like a real burnout guy, you know? Heroin addict. Came to us in the Victorious Overcomers. We got him set free from heroin, got him into God, got him into reading his word, and all of a sudden he had an idea. Yo, man, long hair, you know, tall, skinny, lanky looking. You remember Robert? I'm going to go to culinary school, man. You know, culinary school, all right, got a vision. Let me tell you something. This guy graduated and got hired by the owner of Avon as a personal chef, and flew all around the world, spent so much time with her, cooking for her in Tahiti. Yo, man, live on Barkley, man. You know, it's like, cool, man. You see, God can do Oh, God can do. Amen. Amen. Now, like I said, I'm an Oldsmobile fan. I'm not a great fan of Henry Ford for a couple of reasons. Number one, he was anti-Semitic, so. But Henry Ford once said, there is no man living who cannot do more than he thinks he can do. So you need to get rid of the words, I can't, from your vocabulary. You could do anything and everything that God says you can do. Amen? You can do what seems impossible. Turn to your neighbor and say, well, what are you waiting for? Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Check this out in the Amplified. I would encourage you to write this down. Philippians 4:13. The Amplified says it this way, I have strength for all things in Christ who empowers me. I am ready for anything and equal to anything through him who infuses inner strength into me. I am self-sufficient in Christ's sufficiency. Amen? I'm going to repeat that. I thought that was a good one. I have strength for all things in Christ who empowers me. I am ready for anything and equal to anything through him who infuses inner strength into me. I am self-sufficient in Christ's sufficiency. Amen. Amen? Now understand this. Nothing in life worth achieving comes easy. If it was, every single person on this planet would be a great achiever. But it's not impossible. And through divine favor, it's very much attainable. Very much attainable. Those of you that are looking for promotions or those of you that are looking for jobs, step out of the boat. Don't be small-minded. Fill out an application and go on an interview for something you're not qualified for. I mean, let's talk natural for a second. What do you have to lose? Let's talk spiritual. You're a winner. You can accomplish all things. Listen, you have the advantage. The Holy Spirit in you gives you insight on how to do things that you never knew how to do. We have the advantage. It's almost like cheating. You understand? It's almost like cheating. I got the advantage. It's not based upon my talents. It's based upon God's talents. Amen, man. We should all be multi-billionaires by the end of the week. Get a vision. Don't be small-minded. You will never accomplish great things if you approach your dream or your vision half-heartedly or small-mindedly. Dream big. Aim high. You'll never accomplish great things if you're constantly looking over your shoulder for excuses to lie down and quit. You ever meet a pessimist? Always negative. Yeah, God said I can do all things, but, well, you said it all right. Talk yourself right out of God's blessing and God's will for your life all the time. Don't be small-minded, and don't be so quick to quit. You just never know how much you're capable of achieving until you're willing to give it all you got. How many know Albert Einstein? How many know? Oh, you ruined my joke. No, no. I was going to say, how's he been? Albert Einstein said this, it's only the people who devote themselves to a cause with their whole life, everything that is within them, who become great achievers. You see, you want to be great in the kingdom of God, you need to devote yourself wholeheartedly 100% to God. 100% to God. You need to be that living sacrifice, willing to lay down the things you want to benefit the kingdom of God. You can't serve two masters. It's clear in the Word. I mean, the Bible uses the example of serving God and serving money, but you can't serve God and serve your spouse. You can't make your spouse a god, or you can't serve God and exalt your boss as the one who's the supplier of all your need according to his riches in TD Bank. The banks of heaven are much greater than TD Bank. Amen. We need to wholeheartedly serve God and submit to him. Amen. How many want to be a great achiever? Can you say amen? Amen. We need to be wholeheartedly devoted to God. That means devoted to his word. That means devoted to prayer. That means devoted to serving. That means devoted to learning. That means devoted to relearning. Because some of us have learned some stuff that needs to go away. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, it's not God's will to heal everyone. Lies! We believe lies! Well, you know, God has favorites. John was the beloved. Lies! We're all God's favorite. Amen? Hallelujah. Now, you might be thinking, and if you do, you're in trouble, because when you start thinking, you're already in trouble. But what about all the adversity that I'm experiencing right now? Great achievers excel under pressure. Adversity seems to bring the best out in them. Can you say hallelujah? Hallelujah. See? You're going to make it. When I think about this, I remember the video I showed. Oh, my goodness, it's probably 4 years ago. A-level Christianity. You remember that video? From Pastor Rick Godwin. And he brought out a point about athletes, professional athletes. And something happens with professional athletes, especially when they get into the championship games, the playoffs, the World Series, the Super Bowl. They tend, you know, at the end of the season, their bodies are hurting, you understand? They have injuries. They're wounded. Their knees are stiff. But when it comes to these games, something happens within them, and they start to play harder. Am I right? And they become more aggressive in their game, you know? It's almost like during the season, it almost appears like, well, they're playing it safe throughout the season until the playoffs. But that's not it. This excitement and this overwhelming desire to win, but not just to win the game, to win it all, kicks in. So you have players in the NBA that are playing with the flu or playing with broken bones. Playing with broken bones. And it's just a game. I mean, it's their career, I understand, but it's just a game. It doesn't change life. For us, maybe for them it does. And we need to be like these athletes, these professional athletes who beat their bodies into submission, and it hurts and it's painful, but it's worth the win. We're quick to lie down and quit. Don't do that. Don't do that. Amen? What happened? You right? You guys are in sync again? And I don't mean the boy band. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And we're going to close with this scripture here. It's a long scripture. It's very long. It's 92 verses. I'm kidding. It's not. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Starting at verse 22, when you get there, say amen. We're going to look at the life of an athlete, a spiritual athlete, Paul. This is the Voice translation. Are you ready? Are they Hebrews, God's chosen? Well, so am I. Are they true Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants to the anointed one, the liberating king? I am even more so. I can't believe how foolish I sound. I have worked harder for God's kingdom. I have taken more beatings. I've been dragged in and out of prisons. I have been eye to eye with death. 5 times I've withstood 39 lashes from the Jewish authorities. 3 times I was beaten with rods. 1 time I was almost stoned to death. 3 times I was in a shipwreck. And I spent 1 day and night adrift at sea. I have been on many journeys and faced the most extreme circumstances, perilous rivers, violent thieves, and threats by my own people and by the Gentile outsiders alike. I have faced dangers in the city, in the wilderness, and at sea, and danger from spies among our brothers and sisters. Watch out for those spies from your brothers and sisters. I have survived toil and hardship, sleepless nights, hunger, and thirst without a crumb in sight, bare to the cold. As if these external trials weren't enough, there is the daily stress I feel and anxiety I carry for all the churches under my care. You see what people do to pastors? All the churches under my care. Who is weak without this arousing of empathy? Who gets hurt and offended without this inciting my burning anger? So as you can see, if I have to boast, I will, but only in my own weakness. The God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, He who is worthy of eternal blessing, can confirm that I am telling you the truth. Once in Damascus, the governor under King Aretas had his people in the city looking for me in order to arrest me. But I crouched in a basket and I was lowered out of a window in the city wall and I narrowly escaped his tight grip. And your life stinks because your boss didn't say good morning to you. This boasting will do no good, but I must go on. I will reluctantly tell about visions and revelation from the Lord. Say dreams. I was caught up to the third heaven 14 years ago. Whether I was in my body or out of body, I don't know. Only God knows. But yes, only God knows whether I was in my body or outside my body. But I do know that I was caught up to paradise and heard things so astounding that they cannot be expressed in words. Things no human is allowed to tell. That was the next chapter, by the way, if you didn't figure it out. Because in the original writings, there was no chapters and verses. Right? So here we see Paul went through hell on earth. And the reward was as God took him up to the third heaven. How would you like to go to the third heaven? You see, he persevered and he didn't quit. And no matter what was happening, no matter what his enemies did to him, no matter what his friends did to him, no matter what happened, he kept on and he kept on and he didn't quit. He persevered and it hurt and it was painful and near death, stoned. And I don't mean, yeah, bad stoned. Hit with rocks until almost dead. Have you ever been hit with a rock? Want me to get one? 3 times, whoosh, cat of nine tails, 39 stripes across the back, 3 times. Jesus only did it once, okay? But yet God rewarded him and took him up and showed him things that can't even be expressed, right? We've heard stories, I don't know if it was Jesse, we heard stories of people that have been taken up to heaven where there are colors in heaven that don't even exist on earth. They can't be explained. Don't you want to go? Amen. The greater the adversity, the greater your testimony. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, when's he going to end? Right now. In Micah chapter 7, verse 8, it says, this is the expanded Bible. Micah 7, 8 says, enemy, don't laugh at, don't gloat over me. I have fallen, but I will get up again. I sit in the shadow of trouble now, darkness, but the Lord will be a light for me. Amen. Amen. Don't laugh at me, devil. You think you got me? Well, watch me. I'm getting up. Watch me get up. Look, 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 look. I'm up. You coward, you. Amen. We need to be able to get up. It's not enough just to possess a dream. You must believe that you can, through your God-given ability, fulfill that dream. Believing demands action, correct? You cannot just sit around waiting for it to happen. Dreamers are adventurous dreamers, and they are willing to take a risk. How many of you know how I spell the word faith? R-I-S-K. Faith is spelled R-I-S-K because if it's not a risk, it's not faith. Stepping out, and it's riskful to do it. It's a risky business. Then you're in the faith business. If it's safe, you know, I'm going to step out in faith, and I'm going to go get myself a cup of coffee. That's not faith. It sounds good, but it's not faith. You're able to accomplish that in your own strength. Stepping out in faith is to be able to do something you're not equipped to, or so you think you're not equipped to do. It's stepping out onto nothing and finding something. Amen?
Amen.
I think God is wonderful. God's best for you is victory and success, and don't settle for less. If you refuse to give it all that you have, then you're only cheating yourself out of God's best. If you refuse to give it your all, you're only cheating yourself. And you know what? Human beings just love to cheat themselves. You know, I don't know what it is about this human nature thing. We're supposed to be living in the nature of God and supposed to be thinking like God, but sometimes we think so negatively. Get the negativity out of your life. Get the negativity out of your thinking. It's holding you back. Holding you back from receiving God's best. Can you say amen? Stay focused and don't let anything distract you, because Satan's main objective is to distract you. Amen? WMDs. Remember the WMDs? Weapons of mass destruction. Well, the devil uses weapons of mass distraction. If you're to get anywhere in this life, if you are to get anywhere in this life, you must be constant. You must be unmovable. You must be unshakable. You must be steadfast. When you've done all to stand, keep standing. Amen? Popeye said that, didn't he? That's all I can stand, and I can't stand them. No, that's the wrong one. Okay. I do know Popeye spoke in tongues, though. Skip-a-gup-a-gip-a-goo. Mark out your course and hold to it. Temporary setbacks should never turn you from your course, because there's going to be setbacks. There's going to be, listen, you're in war here. You're a salmon swimming upstream, you know what I mean? There's going to be setbacks. You're going to swim into a rock and go, oh, that hurt. Then you're going to go around the rock, all right? Acts chapter 20, verse 24 in the Amplified. I know, that was the last scripture on that page. This is the last scripture. And you know this scripture, but this is the Amplified. But none of these things move me. Neither do I esteem my life dear to myself, if only I may finish my course with joy, and the ministry which I have obtained from, which was entrusted to me by the Lord Jesus, faithfully to attest to the good news of the gospel of God's grace, his unmerited favor, spiritual blessing, and mercy. Whatever you set your heart upon will be yours. No devil will be able to stop you. Start thinking, start talking, and start acting like a winner. Never again say, I can't. You can, in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
In closing, I'm going to give you 9 characteristics of people who accomplish great things. Number 1, earnestness. Earnestness. Number 2, having an unquenchable desire. Number 3, having unwavering faith. Number 4, and this is the one you're all going to rejoice over, long suffering and patience. Number 5, a willingness to labor tirelessly. That means you need to lose your American culture. because Americans don't like to work. Number six, determination. Number seven, you need to have a deep commitment, not only to God, but to your vision. Number eight, fervency in prayer. You know, nothing happens if you don't pray. Nothing changes if you don't pray. And number nine, you need to have true humility, recognizing that without God, you're nothing. Amen? Did you learn something this morning? How many of you can honestly say you have a vision or a goal or a dream for your life? Raise your hand if you do. Very good. Does it seem impossible for you to reach that dream? No. So your dream is attainable. Okay. Are you working towards that dream? Are you working towards that goal? I'm going to repeat one thing I said. Make sure that your dream is the one God has given you. Right? It has to be in God's will. Pray and make sure, because sometimes we do run ahead of God. Humans have a tendency of doing that. We run ahead of God. During the real estate boom, man, so many believers said, I want to move to Carolina and I want to move to Florida. And a great majority of them have moved back because they just, they got moved by circumstance. Oh, it's great. We're going to get out of this stinking city. Well, it's not a stinking city. You live here. You make it great. It's only stinking if you think it's stinking and you're thinking it's stinking. Okay, if you say so, God. Amen? Listen, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere except outside God's will. Come on, let's sing some Frank Sinatra. Come on.
Start spreading the news.
Right? But if you're out of God's will, it ain't going to work. So make sure it's God's will and God's plan for your life. Amen. Give him a praise. I'm done this morning. Amen. Hallelujah.